Hi. So today we will extend our understanding on this single crystalline, semi-crystalline and non-crystalline systems which we had seen in the previous lecture. So in previous lecture we started with an introduction to X-ray crystallography and we came across these terms. So in crystal, we directly connected crystal to a solid. Crystal is nothing but a solid with a regular periodic arrangement of atoms and molecules inside. So depending on the extent of periodicity, we divide this solid or this crystal into a single crystalline system, polycrystalline system or semi-crystalline system, and amorphous system or non-crystalline system. Same material may be available in one of these forms, can be in single crystalline system or polycrystalline system or amorphous system. Now how basically that material, any matter can be divided into maybe solids and fluids. That is one type of classification we come across, where fluids means liquids and gases. Solids or fluids, where fluids can be liquids or gas state, gaseous system. Or another classification of matter is, the matter can be classified as say condensed matter and gaseous matter. So in which this condensed state we have again two, it can be solids and liquids. So this is how this material is directly simple in a straightforward manner they have classified. So we are interested in solids. Solids where there is regular periodic arrangement, that is what we call it crystals. So when we talk about the solids or crystal, how do we get crystal? When in any natural process, if we pick a crystal or a material from nature, normally that will not be single crystalline, that will not be monocrystalline. Whereas the single crystalline system is artificially made. So this crystallographers, they make it, the process is called crystal growth. So in this crystal growth process, there are certain parameters, maybe certain growth conditions, many types of growth techniques are there. For example, there is melt growth. Then solution growth, then zone refining, then Bridgman growth, etc. So there are different growth techniques are available. And for each growth technique, there will be certain parameters. So we will be having certain temperature, certain fixed pressure and other conditions which are to be monitored. So in general rule, in any growth process, if the process is taking place at very fast, if it is quick, then these constituent particles, they will not have sufficient time to occupy a place or occupy settle in a low energy condition. Only if these atoms and molecules were arranged and they are occupied in a low energy status, then that system will be single crystalline. On the other hand, if we give sufficient time this during this crystal growth process, if it is slow, then all these atoms and molecules, they will get settled in a position or in a configuration which is giving it the lowest energy, and under that condition this system will be forming a single crystalline unit. So whether the single crystalline or monocrystalline, so it greatly depend on growth process. But in addition to that, there are other parameters as well. So if these growth conditions, if these growth parameters are monitored in a proper manner, so if it is fixed growth condition, that is what we call it, there is a constant environment. So if there is a constant environment, that is if the growth parameters are fixed, then the crystal which is formed, that will be in single crystalline and even the external structure that will be remain fixed, or the external structure of the crystal is greatly related to the internal arrangement of atoms and molecules. So, if this internal arrangement of atoms and molecules are given a regular periodic pattern, so naturally that will be reflected in the external appearance as well. So, the growth parameters play a vital role. So, in during this growth process, these conditions are to be properly monitored. So this is the that depends on many parameters, factors, even the expertise of the crystal growth, that person who is involved in, that also plays a vital role. So, the researchers, they learn day by day, they are doing many crystal growth and they are getting that expertise. So, once they are expert, get that required expertise, then they will be able to monitor these crystal growth conditions and they may be even able to grow a single crystalline system. So, in single crystalline system, there will be regular periodic arrangement. We say there is a reticular structure, whereas in the case of polycrystalline system, so these crystallites will be formed. When there is fluctuation in this growth parameters, these crystallites, small units, will be formed. These crystallites are nothing but they are interlocking masses with maybe a random orientation and having separate boundary. That is, in between crystallites there will be boundary, we call it grains and grain boundary, and this grain boundary is defect region. So, it is moving from single crystalline to defect condition. So, more crystallite units will be there, but in a small region, if we take that is neighboring atoms, there will be crystallinity in crystallites, whereas in a large scale in the inside the material, it will be losing its crystallinity. So, we call it polycrystalline system. But this polycrystalline system, if we grow in a controlled manner, instead of polycrystallinity, we can get single crystallinity in the growth process. In a polycrystalline system, one advantage is that because of this random distribution of crystallites, they all have got or if we think about the property of the crystal system, then the properties will be identical in any direction. We say that the polycrystalline system exhibit isotropy in properties. Isotropy means because there is no preferred direction, any direction there will be crystallite and at random it is distributed. So, whereas in the case of amorphous, there is no regularity in the system and it is we call it there is neither granular structure nor reticular structure. So, that is such a system is what we call amorphous system. Peculiarity of amorphous system is that it does not have sharp melting point. In the case of crystalline system, these different atoms or molecules which are available within the crystal system, they are having interlocked or the bond strength. Interatomic bond is of equally strong, whereas in the case of this amorphous system, this interlocking or these interatomic bonds are unequal or strength is unequal. So, because of that, if the crystalline system is heated, then all these bonds will be broken at the same temperature. So, because all the bonds are of equally strong, so when they break, then this single crystalline system or solid will be moving shifting to the liquid state. For example, ice. In ice, all these interatomic bonds are of equally strong, so that when we give heat at that particular temperature 0 degrees Celsius, ice will be changing to water state. Whereas, in the case of an amorphous system, these bonds are not equally strong. So, when we give heat, these weak bonds will be broken first. Whereas the strong bonds, it needs more heat energy. Therefore, because of that, it will be moving from a hard state to a soft state or a flexible state, or there will be reduction or drop in viscosity, and finally it may exhibit or it may become a highly viscous liquid. So, the example for this amorphous systems are, we have say glass. Glass is an example for amorphous system. Then plastic. Plastic is an example for amorphous system, then resin, sugar candy, etc. So, I just selected these examples in such a way that you can easily remember. So, GPRS. So, glass, plastic, resin, sugar candy, etc. These are all some of the examples of amorphous system. So, they will show some flexibility. If we start heating, initially it will be hard structure, but gradually it becomes softer and flexible. So this is amorphous system. In the case of a polycrystalline system, we have examples. There is many of the materials which we see in nature, they are polycrystalline nature. Example, say metals, rock, then salt, sand. These are all examples for polycrystalline system. So here also I have used these letters in such a way that you can easily remember. So this MRS is a common acronym for Material Research Society. I mean, many of the countries they have got Material Research Society. This is an example. So you can take it as Material Research Society Singapore. So these metals, rocks, salt, sand, etc. So these are all examples for a polycrystalline system. So this crystallinity depends on how this periodicity or how the atoms and molecules are arranged inside the material. That is what we call it crystallinity. So after having an understanding on these different material systems and their crystallinity, now the point is, you know, how will we express or how will we depict this periodicity within the material. So we should have an understanding, we have to visualize how these materials or atoms or molecules are arranged in a periodic manner within a system. So for that, a technique or a method was first introduced by Breuys. So in 1848, Breuys introduced this technique, Breuys. So Breuys or Breuys. So according to him, or he introduced a technique what we call space lattice. So this space lattice is an easy way to understand the periodicity within a crystal system. So this is based on translation operation. So a translation operation is used, translation. So translation means shifting. If we say that we give a translation of an object, so imagine I have got an object J. If I am giving a translation of this object through a distance A in this particular direction, what I mean is that this object will be available at equal distance A apart. So this will continue to infinity. So this type of translation, so if we are giving this J a translation of A in a particular direction, we will be getting a linear array of J's. We say that a linear that is array. So this is what we call it linear translation or one dimensional translation, or this is called one dimensional lattice, one dimensional lattice array of J's. So this J is not significant in this case, whether it is J or A or X or Y, whatever it is, this if this point is more important. Because even if you remove this J, you will have these points. So these points are getting repeated. And to that point, you are attaching J's. So that gives, if it is given translation in one direction, you will be getting one dimensional linear lattice. So in addition to this one dimensional translation, suppose you are giving a second translation non-collinear to this first one. So in that case, so we will be getting, so we have one translation, say J like that. So along with this translation J from left to right, we are giving another translation B in some other direction. So suppose I am giving a translation B in this direction. So we will have a J here as well. So this is B and this is your A. And here also you will have J, here also you will have J, and here also you have J like that. So this is J and this is again you have got the translation A. So this is A unit translation, this is B unit translation in another direction. So you will be getting a linear, you will be getting a two-dimensional lattice. So what you are getting is a two-dimensional lattice. This is called two-dimensional lattice or a plane lattice. So here if we omit J, you will have points. So, these points only we are interested in. So, these points are having a regular periodic manner, and to that point we are attaching J. Now, in addition to these two translations, A and B translation, suppose we incorporate a third non-coplanar translation, C. If that is also incorporated, then this A, B and C. Suppose if these A, B and C translations are given along three crystallographic directions X, Y and Z, then the combined effect of these X, Y and Z, or combined effect of the three translations A, B and C, we will be getting a three-dimensional lattice. So, that is what we call it, space lattice. So, let us see. So, I will draw this space lattice here, one square I am plotting. One, then I take an x square another square. I take next square, okay, all these, then these are all lattice points, I just mark it as with this black dot, these are all points where you can attach one basis. So, here is one point. So, these are all different lattice points and we can connect these lattice points. So, it is given, actually this lattice is formed by translation along X, Y and Z direction. So, I take this as X direction, this as your Y direction and this is your C direction. So, the translation along X direction I mark it as A unit, and translation along this Y direction we will mark it as B unit, and translation along this Z direction we will mark it as C. So, these are the three translation vectors or translation operation we have given to this object or lattice points. So, when I mark it, so we will be getting. So, here this is one point, here there is one, here connection, these are all connected. So, what you are getting is a three-dimensional lattice. So, in this three-dimensional lattice, if you take any particular lattice point which is having a particular peculiar environment around it. So, a same environment will be available across around any particular, any other atom in this lattice. So, such a distribution of points, that is what we call it space lattice. So, this space lattice will give us an information about how the atoms and molecules are arranged in a regular periodic pattern inside the material. So, this is the idea proposed by Breuil in 1848. So, in this case we are taking this A, B and C as the translation vectors along three crystallographic directions X, Y and Z, with any particular lattice point as the origin. So, from this particular lattice point origin, so we can reach any other lattice point through a translation operation. So, for example, if we give a translation T is equal to N1A plus N2B plus N3C, from this any particular lattice point you will be able to reach some other lattice point. So, where N1, N2 and N3 are integers. So, suitable integers you have to choose and then you will be able to find out another lattice point. So, this is what we call it space lattice. If it is a two-dimensional lattice, then we need only N1A plus N2B, but simple way we will just start with a linear one-dimensional lattice where the translation is along a line. Then we add a non-collinear translation B, then we get a two-dimensional plane lattice. Now we introduce a third non-coplanar translation and we get this complete space lattice. So, this crystal when we visualize, we are supposed to visualize in terms of this lattice, and as we have already seen, these repeating objects are not significant, but it is the point that is matter. This point means in physics or in a system, when we speak about a point, Point is an infinitesimally small dot or a spot. So it does not have a physical space. So it is a very, very tiny dot, and so this is a collection of such dots. So hence we call it space lattice or point lattice. So it is a point lattice which helps us to understand the distribution of atoms and molecules within a crystalline system. Now to this space lattice, if we attach bases, a basis means it is an atom or a group of atoms or ions which are having identical orientation, identical structure, nature, all these are identical. So these type of basic unit, that bases are when attached, actually this is imaginary, point is imaginary, space lattice is also imaginary. To this imaginary structure or framework, if we attach these bases, so suppose we have a basis of this kind, imagine this is a pattern, I am having a basis of this nature. So if this basic nature, basis is are attached to this space lattice, what you are getting is a crystal. So what we say that this framework plus basis will give you crystal. I will be marking it like this. So one basic unit, then another one like this if you attach. So we had initially a framework that was our space lattice, and to this space lattice now we attach this particular basic unit, this is considered as a basis. So when basis is attached, now this is a crystal, this is a crystal which is having a peculiar pattern of arrange or a peculiar pattern of atoms or molecules or a basis arranged in a regular pattern, and this will have a particular nature. So this crystal will exhibit its property. Now this crystal, when we speak about these atoms or bases, these they are all very, very small things. So that is why when we say that translation operation, it translates this part, this particular units infinite number of times. So in one direction there is infinite number of j's. So that is, we have got infinite collection of points, that is what is space lattice, because atom size is around 10 to the power minus 10 meter, 1 angstrom. So that means it is extremely small unit. So extremely, so if we take 1 centimeter cube of a material, then it is having infinite collection of atoms, infinite collection of lattice points. So that is a big task. So instead of going for such big data, we are interested in simple units, there is small simple units which we can easily handle. So those simple units which when repeated in 3 dimension, when they are stacked in 3 dimension, this space lattice or this crystal will be reproduced. Such a small unit is what we call it, unit cell. So unit cell is the small volume or a small region within this space lattice, or we should be able to stack it in such a way that this crystal or this space lattice should be reproducible. So if that particular unit is selected, then that small unit is what we call it, unit cell. So unit cell when stacked together, we should be able to reproduce this crystal or a space lattice. Now the question is, which pair? So when we take 2 dimensional lattice, there are 2 translational operation. If we take 3 dimensional 3D space lattice, then we have got 3 translation operation, A, B and C along 3 crystallographic directions. Now the question is, which pair or which triplet should be selected in order to define this unit cell? For example, suppose we have got a 2D space lattice or 2 dimensional plane lattice. See, we have got a 2D lattice here like this. So this indicates a 2D lattice which was formed due to the translation along 2 directions, 2 non-collinear directions, and we got this lattice. So in this 2 dimensional lattice, there are many translation operation possible, infinite number of translation operation, because connecting any 2 lattice point, that is a translation. For example, if I take this direction, this is one translation operation. If I take this direction, this is another translation operation. If I take like this way, then I will be getting one translation operation. So if I take this direction, then again I will be getting one translation operation. So we have got infinite collection of translation operation possible in a particular lattice. Therefore, when we define a unit cell, which pair, if it is two dimensional lattice, which pair, if it is three dimensional lattice, which triplet of translation will we consider. So this is based on, or it is defined based on these crystallographic directions. So we are interested in crystallographic directions x, y and z. In that x, y and z direction, if we take three translation operation, which are the smallest possible. For the example, in this case, suppose I take this as your x direction and this as your y direction, then this is the smallest possible translation. We can have a translation from here to here as well, but that is not the smallest one, here as well. So the smallest translation is this one. This distance is the smallest translation, this distance is also the smallest translation. So if we take three translation operations along x, y and z directions, c directions, such that the translation is the smallest possible, the gap between the two adjacent lattice points is the minimum, then the corresponding unit cell so formed is what we call it primitive unit cell. Primitive unit cell. So in the case of three dimensional space lattice, if we take such a primitive unit cell, it will be having the shape of a parallelepiped, a parallelepiped having sides A, B and C. So when parallelepiped is having that minimum size A, B and all, minimum side length A, B and C, A, B and C are the translation operation or translation vectors, then that will give you the minimum volume within the primitive unit cell, and that will be having only one lattice point inside. So such a lattice or such a unit cell is what we call it primitive unit cell, and its volume is given by V is equal to the box product A, B and C. We call it A dot B cross C. So this is what the volume of the primitive unit cell. So in primitive unit cell, when we calculate this volume, we need the angle between A, B and C. So that angle between A, B and C are marked as in the following way. That is, we have three crystallographic directions x, y and c, and we have this primitive these translations A, B and C. So I write it again, C, A, B. So in this case, this angle between B and C is called, if we take B and C as a translation vector, then angle between B and C is alpha, and angle between C and A is, angle between C and A is A and C. So we will be having beta, and angle between A and B, A and B will be gamma. So these are the three angles we generally take, and if you use these, you will be able to plot a primitive unit cell in this pattern. So this is your primitive unit cell, this is your A translation vector A, here your translation vector C, this is your translation vector B, and the angle between A and B is, angle between A and B is gamma, angle between A and C is beta, and angle between B and C is alpha. So and its volume will be given by this box product A, B and C. So this more about this unit cell we will see in our this forthcoming lecture. Thank you.